But I know you're going to be a great audience the day you get on the ship, because I watch you when you board. That's how I know you're going to be a good audience. Because the truth is, before you take the vacation, you're a little uptight. You know what I mean? Are the bills going to be paid? The mail collected? The dog's going to be fed? Everything going to be okay? Do we have all of our papers in order? You can't really sleep the night before. There's a little anxiety. You get up 2 hours early to go to the airport because they have to check and make sure you're not a terrorist. They're patting down a 67-year-old white woman, an 8-year-old black kid. Meanwhile, a guy with a turban, a beard, and a stick of dynamite in his mouth walked right by. But nobody's going to say anything because you don't want to appear racist in any form. You get on the flight, they don't serve peanuts, or they do serve peanuts, they don't serve food anymore. For some reason, food had something to do with terrorism. In fact, you're lucky to get peanuts on some of these flights. And they don't cost peanuts, I'll tell you that. Then you land, it takes longer to get the luggage than it did the flight. You get down to the ship, you think you're home free, but no, bingo, some more paperwork, a little more security check. All of a sudden you walk through this one door and somebody goes, smile! And you people smile. Despite all the stress and strain, you smiled and I go, this is going to be a good audience. You get on the ship, you find your cabin, and then you start to explore this wondrous, beautiful ship. And you get a souvenir drink in that beautiful glass to take home to your friends. You meet people, they buy you a drink, you buy them a drink. They buy you a drink, you buy them a drink. You're getting a buzz on and it's time for the lifeboat drill. Report to your muster station. You notice those people are half-crocked? Have you noticed that? Did you notice they found a guy on 6 naked with his life jacket on? He said he just wanted to see what it felt like. No, people are drunk going to their muster station. One guy showed up with 2 hot dogs. But I watched you, ladies and gentlemen. I watched your faces as they showed the video. And they explain to you, if you hear that one signal, you calmly stop whatever you're doing. You're shaking dice, you put them down. You're eating a sandwich, you stop. And then you quietly walk to your room, get your life jacket, quietly and calmly walk to your muster station. You people were so attentive. I watched you as you put on your life jackets. I've watched a lot of crowds. You were the best. I watched you tie them up, and I saw your faces as they explained. Not only did you have a life jacket, but you had a light and a whistle. And I saw the look of peace that came over your faces. As you realized, there was nothing to fear on God's earth. Didn't matter what happened. In your cabin was a life jacket with a light and a whistle. Now, since then, some of you have become angry because you've looked at that inky black ocean and you started thinking, what was I so excited for? And I'm going to be honest with you, and I can be honest with you. I'm just your comedian, all right? I'm not part of the crew or anything. I can be honest with you. You hear that signal, you're not quietly walking to your cabin. We've all seen the Titanic. We know what happens. You scream and run like hell. That's what you do. Go to your cabin and fight the steward for that life jacket. And find out he knows more English than you ever imagined. I'm telling you the truth, you know, and some of you have become angry because you looked at that inky black ocean and you got so angry because you realize we're between Los Angeles and Honolulu. What good is that light and that whistle? Why were you so excited? Did you see that light? That teeny tiny, a doctor could have looked down your throat with that light. Like a little glow worm. And then you thought of the whistle. If the light ain't going to do it, what's the whistle all about? There you are, bobbing up and down in the middle of the ocean. Between Los Angeles and Honolulu. Who's going to hear you? A shark? Do you ever think they're trying to get rid of the evidence? Have you ever thought of that? Well, there's a 2,000-something people. No, 80 people. We had 80 people one there. Now we have the documentation right here. There it is. Do you know who they send out, ladies and gentlemen, if we have trouble? Do you know who they send out to save us, to rescue us? The United States Coast Guard. And they send out propeller-driven aircraft. Have you ever flown on propeller-driven aircraft? Hey, Joe, did you hear a whistle? No, I didn't hear anything. Well, let's go down another 5,000 feet. Maybe we'll see a light. So let me give you my advice. If anything happens, go to the buffet. It's on the top of the ship. It's the last thing to go. Get a sandwich and a piece of pie. Make the shark happy. Play for time. But I think we're okay, don't you, ladies and gentlemen? Yes, I mean, we know because we see this crew drill. They go through it all the time. It's a $500 million. Everybody's very conscious of safety. And that's why we can actually kid about something like this. And it is such a beautiful ship. And your cabins, aren't they gorgeous, ladies and gentlemen, your cabins? Yes, just like the brochure, actual size. That's that why they call it a love boat. You better be in love, baby, let me tell you. Because you're going to be close together. By applause, we're the people with the inside cabins. Oh, come on now. It's okay. Because I know they're dark. I know they're dark. And I want to salute you for your bravery. Just walk in them. That's a brave... Bats won't fly into those things, man, let me tell you. That's darker than looking up a Mau Mau's Moo Moo at midnight. I mean, that you can tell the people with the inside cabins at the buffet. They have on the sunglasses and they have the canes. They walk around. Now, my cabin is on deck Z. Way down, Moses, way down. Down on deck Z, and it's not very roomy. In fact, let me tell you how small my cabin is.
How small is it?
Well, let's remember I'm talking about my cabin. I'm going to use an old Fred Allen joke to tell you how small my cabin is. And here's a name a lot of you haven't heard in a long, long time. I'm one of the few comedians to actually use P. Diddy and Fred Allen in a monologue. And incidentally, Fred never changed his name through a whole career. Did you ever notice that? They used to do that, get one name and stick with it. That was sort of interesting. Okay, my room is so small, when I shut the door, the knob gets into bed with me. But I lived in Hollywood long enough to know how to enjoy it. First part of the joke was Fred's, the last part was mine. Now, it is a small cabin. I don't need a remote, you know, to change the channels. I just use my toes, just put them up there. But my cabin has what your cabin has, ladies and gentlemen. My cabin has what every crew member's cabin has. My cabin has whatever deluxe suite on this ship has. My cabin has what even the captain has. It has a toilet that works. That when you flush, baby, there is power. Because you get on the ship and you make fun of it because it says, shut that lid before you flush. And people joke and think that's funny until that first and that suction scares the living hell out of people. Of course, some of them challenge fate. We lose 2 to 3 passengers every cruise. They wash up on Baja. Oh, more crappy Americans. The power of those toilets, it's almost like the old joke. If we all went down and flushed on cue, we'd be in Hilo in 15 minutes. Like a giant hovercraft.